It's been described as the second hardest job in America. An ad for the first lady might read something like this: Wanted, remarkable woman, willing to work without pay. Must offer opinions on subjects from fashion to hunger to peace in the Middle East. Benefits include travel to exotic war-torn locales and endless paparazzi. No experience necessary, perfection preferred. There's no real job description for the first lady. Instead, the position is shaped by the women who hold it, and all of the nation's first ladies have served in their own ways.
The hugely popular Dolly Madison did not escape censure for her use of cosmetics and snuff, not to mention spending $11,000 on refurbishing a shabby executive mansion.
It's no bed of roses. First ladies are criticized for the way they dress, how they decorate the White House, even how they style their hair.
You know, Mrs. Reagan used to get her hair done every other day. So every other day it looked great, and every other day it looked not so great. And but on the days that it didn't look great, I kid you not, we would hear about it. We'd get the phone calls.
There's no fun to keep the first lady looking great. Hair and clothing expenses come out of their own pockets, just like America's other ladies.
The level of scrutiny is such that there's just no margin for error. And I think that is something every modern first lady faces, but I think it just gets even more and more so just because of cable TV and the 24/7 news cycle.
Despite the scrutiny, first ladies influence policy and play important roles in diplomacy. Their staffs say they have the ability to do things behind the scenes in ways their husbands can't. For instance, Gail Hodges Burt, former Reagan social secretary, says Nancy Reagan often deflected slings and arrows intended for the Gipper and even helped facilitate critical talks between Reagan and Mikhail Gorbachev during the Cold War.
People now recognize that there is a person there, there is a brain there.
And of course, each first lady champions her own cause.
What every first lady discovers early on, sometimes to her surprise, is just what a remarkable platform she has been given, just how far her voice can carry. And that can be used for all sorts of positive things, but it's also sometimes a warning. If she says something off message or politically controversial, that there may be a price to pay.
Laura Bush championed women's rights in Afghanistan, pushing for education and preventative health care.
What I loved most about her is that she never forgot a detail. She connected with people really all over the world. She paid attention to who they are and what her environment was, and really, really connected.
Susan Scher, longtime friend and former chief of staff to Michelle Obama, says Mrs. Obama developed an interest in helping military families after hearing their stories on the campaign trail with her husband.
That left an impact on her, and she was very clear from the beginning that she wanted to work with military families to ease their burdens if there was a way to do that.
Interest in the current first family is perhaps unprecedented, but the Obamas aren't afraid to steal private moments in the midst of public events.
Some of the photos that I've seen where they're, you know, sort of taking a private moment in a very public arena is something that I think it's important to them, no matter what else happens, to keep the relationship going.
Those who've worked for first ladies say the thing Americans often forget is that the women playing America's hostess also have to deal with the everyday challenges of life.
Mrs. Reagan had breast cancer. The president had colon cancer. There was an attempted assassination on him. Her mother died while she was in office.
They must also absorb criticism.
I mean, think about it. This is the person she cares most for in her life, that she loves so deeply, yet day to day was pretty brutal, and that she was able to create this sanctuary around their family that really was the where they derived a great deal of strength.
So what about the day when America welcomes its first female president and her first gentleman to the White House?
I think in our lifetime, we may very, very well see a woman president, and then perhaps the title will be retired. And more important, maybe the double standard will be retired, because I guarantee you people won't pay as much attention to what the first gentleman wears or how he styles his hair. And then maybe that'll be the ultimate success of the modern women's movement, that everyone is assessed by the same standards.
Until then, America's first ladies will continue to shape their unelected office and leave their marks on American history. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.